Hey guys, this is Eric Young, and you're listening to Booking the Territory.
Hey, this is Ring of Honor Superstar Donovan Dijak, and you're listening to Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast.
This is the one-man gang. You're listening to Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast.
This is Booking the Territory, a pro wrestling podcast hosted by Mike Mills, Heartbody Harper from Wildcat Sports and Entertainment, and the mentally irregular Doc Turner. This podcast is a mix of your topics and thoughts in the world of pro wrestling, along with interviews and discussions with current independent stars and your favorite stars from the past. And now, here's your host, Mike Mills.
Welcome back, everyone, for this week's episode of Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast. We are the pro wrestling podcast where pro wrestling's past meets pro wrestling's present. This week's show is another loaded one. Heck, they're all loaded, but seriously, this week's top five is the top five sellers in the history of wrestling. We're not talking about merchandise sellers. We're talking about actual sellers, like, for example, Ricky Morton knew how to sell, for example. So, yeah, that's the top five this week, and that is brought to you by @OldWrestlingPick on Twitter. It was their idea, so go throw them a follow and all their great old wrestling picks that they post all the time and some cool old school posts that they throw up and polls and whatnot. We've also got a bunch of emails, Twitter shout-outs, Facebook shout-outs. I got some emails on the new Tony Schiavone podcast. I actually got a Lucha Underground question. And lastly, if you listened to the entire show last week at the end of it, you heard me mention that this week's guest is courtesy of my friends Mark Madison and John Curry from the Main Event Madness podcast. And it is an interview with WWF legend Tito Santana on this week's show that was conducted by Mark Madison. It was probably over a year ago at this time. But with all that said, Doc, how you doing, man?
Hola.
Harper, how are you? I'm not going to entertain his fucking stupidity this early in the show.
We had Tito Santana on. I just wanted to reach out to him. I got to build the bridge back after some of the things you've been saying about our Hispanic audience.
No. That show hasn't even aired yet, and I did not say anything about our Hispanic audience.
What I'm doing in broadcasting is teasing the future. And let me tell the people out there, it was so bad that I need to start apologizing for it in advance.
It wasn't bad. We have a very, very diverse population. We have a very, very high, you know, Latino audience. And I just, because we get a lot of downloads from, like, believe it or not, we get a lot of downloads from Mexico. I mean, it shows up on Podbean when I look it up. But I didn't say anything bad. I don't know, Harper. I can't see what they look like. But, I'm trying to get it out and I can't do it. Look, I'll just tell y'all what happened. Robert Gibson was getting beat with a leather belt on an upcoming Smoky Mountain episode. And I described his back as being wet and it would hurt if someone were to hit you and your back was wet. And these assholes made it racial.
You're one of Trump's new border soldiers, aren't you?
Oh, Jesus Christ.
We're not. I got a different question. What do you think the percentage chance that Beyonce's twins are actually that Nas is the father instead of Jay-Z?
Well, everything's a fucking work. I actually just posted it on my Twitter account not even 10 minutes ago. Did you see that, Harper? She's pregnant with twins?
Yeah, I saw that.
Okay, not that she's pregnant with twins is a work, but if you recall her last album, just to go to show you how everyone does wrestling better than wrestling, once again, we're circling back to this discussion. Her last album was all about lyrics where it seemed like she was talking about Jay-Z and they were breaking up and all this bullshit. Well, she pops up pregnant with twins today. I'm assuming they're with Jay-Z, but, I mean, she is married to him. But it just goes to show you, she put in a lot of lyrics that made all these fucking women out there just go, oh, shit, she's fucking hot. And, you know, if there's one thing women can relate to, it's a woman who's scorned and upset about a man. So she put all these lyrics in that album, and it sold like hotcakes. And a year later, oh, me and Jay are so married. We're just with twins, and can't wait for it. You got fucking worked. And I said it. When that shit came out, that album came out, I was like, my wife and mother-in-law were in there watching that bullshit on VH1. Ooh, girl, ooh, this,
Lemonade.
Yeah, I was like, that shit's a work.
I think I even said it on one of our shows. I was like, that's a work. She's working. She's selling albums. No, it ain't. You think everything's a work. Fuck, it is. Shit.
Everything's a fucking work, dude. Everything is a fucking work. Nothing just fucking happens without it being choreographed, bro. I mean, it just, that's just the way it is. Nothing just happens.
Right. Especially for the music industry like that. I mean, come on. How naive can you be? So anyway, in today she pops up with twins. So that's how we spent the first 5 minutes of this week's podcast. Talking about Beyonce working the marks because wrestling can't do it anymore. It's obvious. Harper, how are you, man? You doing all right?
Doing all right, man.
All right, y'all. Well, let's get into the show. Doc, you got anything before we throw it over to our Twitter and Facebook shout-outs?
No.
Okay, I didn't think so. He's sitting there on mute because he has nothing to contribute at this point. Again, let's get some BTT signs on Raw and SmackDown and ROH and NXT and, hell, Impact. Wherever you are, if you are a BTT listener, let's get the signs up at these live shows and help spread the word about Booking the Territory Pro Wrestling Podcast. All right, I got a shout-out for William Shepherd, one of our longtime listeners on Facebook. He sent me a list. He said, here's my list for what made me fall in love with wrestling in order. Number 5, and I want y'all to tell me what y'all think about this. Hogan becoming the third member of the NWO. And he says,
whatever.
Well, hold on. This is good. He says, not because it was Hogan, but because of the reaction my great-grandmother had. She said, and I quote, I always knew that motherfucker was a dirty cocksucker.
That's nice.
Damn, Granny.
She was, William says she was 83 years old at that time when she said that.
Man, we've always said that, man, back in the day, Granny was the fan in the crowd you had to watch if you were a heel, because she had a knife in her purse. Come on now.
Grannies back in the day in wrestling were a great thing. I do agree with that. His number 4 was HBK versus Bret Hart, WrestleMania 12, the Iron Man match, the boyhood dream, whatever. The story build-up to it was great, and it was the two best workers of its time. Harper, you and I both had that, and we actually had it at number 4 too, didn't we?
Mm-hmm.
Coincidentally, I went back and watched that this weekend, and I must say...
The whole thing?
Yeah, I did, man. I did. It's not as slow as you remember, but it's not as fast as I remember either. It was, but it's well-paced. I mean, it was good. Williams' number 3 was the Sting versus Flair at the Clash. It was the building blocks of WCW, and it was the first time he says he couldn't turn away from his TV. It was the greatest of all time, and the only man who could ever take his place putting on a great show. The only sad thing was WCW could never catch that feeling again and hold it. Yeah, WCW had some lame moments, that's for sure, even between the wars and all that. He said number 2 was his Savage versus Steamboat moment. He said it's the only match that will ever get 6 stars. Also said that his number 1, y'all are going to love this. Number 1 reason that he loves or fell in love with pro wrestling or continues to love it is the Jim Cornette Experience, Booking the Territory podcast, and the 605 Super podcast. Awesome. Like many fans, have fallen out of love with today's product. But you 3 shows have constantly redeemed the sport and the art of wrestling. No matter what the WWE puts out, I can count on these shows to produce a legit and fun time every week and not trying to blow smoke. But at work, the BTT Pod and Smoky Mountain Review are the only 2 podcasts that my coworkers are playing.
Great. Buy a fucking t-shirt.
I knew he was going to say that. Oh, Harper. Good job, man. That's how you do it. At Sparks Third Coast. If y'all remember last week, I mentioned we were going to get drunk and do a patron-only episode. He said, you can't do that. That's the Ric Flair show's gimmick.
We can do whatever we want, pal.
I'm grown.
Hey, why do y'all think Flair is now all of a sudden, his podcast with Conrad is gone, but he's coming back and he's going to have a new co-host? You hear about that?
I can't find anything on that.
It seems really weird, but whatever. So
he severed ties with the Conrad guy?
I don't know. I don't want to start a rumor that he severed ties. I mean, no one has said anything. It's just that one day, I remember, I think it was after the Nasty Boys he had on the podcast, which that podcast is hilarious, listening to Knobs is shit-faced on that podcast. I mean, he's like fucking gone, just shit-faced out of his mind. And Sags doesn't seem to be drunk, though. He seems to be level-headed. But Rick sounded pretty drunk. And then I think that was the last one that they did, and after that they were like, that's it, no more Flair show, and I think they tweeted about it, and it was done. I don't know what the deal was with it. Really, really strange, but anyway. But it's coming back because they tweeted out that he's going to have, I forget the guy's name, but he's going to have another co-host. So this will be his third attempt, Doc. That's your boy, though, right?
Greatest wrestler of all time.
I agree. Nah, I don't. Hot Shiznit 007 on Twitter. This is a cool thing. Missy Hyatt. Jesus Christ. Harper's over there stroking that yeah. mouthpiece.
She likes Trump.
She like Missy Hyatt does?
Yeah, she's a big, like, conservative chick.
What, does she tweet that out or something? I'm asking.
Yo, yeah,
I don't
she
know.
Does. Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
Yeah, she don't hide it.
Okay. Well, Missy Hyatt tweeted out that she had a 100-mile drive ahead of her last Friday. Are there any podcast recommendations? At Hot Shiznit 007 said that Missy, you need to check out at BTT podcast. So I really appreciate it. And then he said he was about to go sign up to become a patron member, which he did do. So and he said, I can't wait to tell Doc to fuck off. So there you go, Doc. At Hot
Shiznit
007.
You want me to translate that into Mark speak? And hey, Missy, if you're out there, hey, I went to your Wrestling Vixens site a long time ago. I saw you naked. How about that?
Yeah.
Yeah. Mm.
It's not like Sunny, huh?
Well, let's just say that. I don't know. I'm going to keep it classy in case Missy's listening. She might want to come on the show sometime.
She might. Who knows?
She's a welcome. She'd be welcome to talk about the old days. I mean, world class, Mid-South.
Yeah.
WC.
She's been in all the great territory. So, at TwitDust on Twitter, he said, I've become a BTT podcast a patron for their outstanding, fresh, and ad-free work. He claims he will also buy from Amazon via the 605 pod. He then went on to say, fuck the WWE millionaire beggars if you're... And then he told me, if I add a fucking blue apron or motherfucking cancer ambulance chasing Texas lawyer ad like Pritchard, he would regret this. You're the only fuckers getting my patron money as of today. I'm not sending WWE X millionaires money. I thought that was pretty awesome. Doc is a little mad at me, though, these days, because he says I'm passing up lucrative commercial deals.
Hey, We'll take money. We will have sponsors if we want to. And here's the other thing.
Once I figure out
how to get these shows behind the paywall, y'all are fucked. You guys, all you Trumpsters out there, like your walls. I'll build a wall on you, sons of bitches. I'll wall each and every one of you out. So here, and while we're at it, while we're here, let me just go ahead and say this.
Harper's over there trying to get his fucking headset over to Trump.
Wait, hold on. I got it.
Okay.
The Trump wall is giving Harper's headset problems.
The wall has already started construction, and unfortunately, Harper didn't get in before we got the wall started. Let me tell you something. I went to iTunes today. We got 44 reviews on it. Now, we have more than 44 people listening to our shows, don't we?
Yeah.
Obviously we do.
I hope so.
Yeah, they don't.
Okay, so what that means is we've got a bunch of lazy motherfuckers out there minus 44. So you know what I think we ought to do? No more Smoky Mountain until we get a certain number of reviews. Let's just turn off the faucet on that. Let's just no more Smoky Mountain until we get let's say 55 reviews, 5-star reviews on iTunes. How you like that?
Yeah.
You're blowing smoke. Build... Your fucking ego is too big to do that. Your ego won't allow that.
I will build the wall, my friend.
You're full of bullshit is what you are, so let's keep it moving.
Do not underestimate how much I cannot stand these people. I will cut off my nose to spite my own face on this.
He's full of bullshit playing heel. There you go again. Dude, you are the worst.
And let me tell
ever.
You something.
Who is you?
Whatever this... what is his name? Twitter...
Just
Dust?
Twit Dust. He's one of our patrons. Leave him alone.
Twit Dust.
I don't care. If somebody... If NAMBLA calls and says they want to give us $1 million to advertise, we might do that shit. That's our right.
Well, see, he's mad at me because I haven't taken the commercial deals I've been given. And he's mad because of that. So fuck
what's that
got
to do with him?
He's mad because he wants the money from it. And I'm like, no, we're staying ad free. We have one small sponsor and that's it. I don't want a blue fucking apron playing in the middle of my show. I don't want it. Well, actually, Cornette does the blue apron commercial good to me, but like
I want a Casper mattress, bro.
Damn right.
What you gonna do on that Casper mattress, Hopper?
Sleep like a motherfucker.
Fuck sleep. Fuck sleep. Fuck sleep. Just like that. I fucking order.
Well, Hopper,
yeah, I could use some fresh ingredients that are sent straight to my home so that we could prepare the meal. You know, it really does bring the family together when you have fresh ingredients that you can put together and cook the portions yourself.
At Fake Stan Lane, we're going to move on. At Fake Stan Lane says, he went back and watched the Cena versus RVD match. He told me I wasn't shitting. They wanted to hang that prick. Now, we talked about that last week, that match a little bit. And I don't know. I felt that was for modern wrestling, so to say, even though it was 10 years ago, over 10 years ago. I thought that was a good match. But I rewatched
it last night.
And what'd you think?
I think if you people go watch it, you would definitely cut Cena a break for how he handled it, that he's a more of a worker than he gets credit for by the general population. Because that could have gone real poorly if he was as bad of a worker as people say he is.
I've said that 100 times every time I watch that match. Cena held his composure in that match together like it was unbelievable the way he held it together. The other thing,
and I wanted to ask you this, is I thought at the beginning the crowd did their job 100%. They were into it. They were creating a hostile environment. They were actually playing the role of a hot-assed crowd. By the end of it, I thought they were kind of going into business for themselves and trying to pop themselves instead of letting the match do the work for them.
Maybe a little, but I mean, it was still real to them. They weren't working, if you ask me, because it was that was a real situation that he was in. That scene.
They chanted some foul stuff at him too.
Yeah, but that's what made it great. I mean, it was real. That was the best part about it. I didn't have any issues with it. You know, the way it went down was perfect. I mean. You know, and I don't know, Hopper. You've been out there in front of hostile crowds. You've seen it. I mean, do you not respect how Cena held it together?
Because he could have fucked up. Like, he could have let that shit get to him, but he didn't.
Yeah, it will fuck with your head when people start doing that to you. I mean,
so
let me ask you guys this. What?
I know the answer is no, but do you think he had ever been in front of anything like that before?
No.
Maybe. That's what impressed me because I don't know that. I mean, he might have been. I think he was a heel in OVW, but was a special kind of right.
Not like that. Literally 100% of your audience legitimately wants you dead.
He threw that shirt in the crowd at the beginning, and they tossed that shit back like it was a home run baseball in a
Wrigley.
Yeah, throw it back, and it just kept coming. He kept throwing it, and it kept coming back. So my whole point is that not only did he keep his composure, not only did he do a great job, that was the first time he'd ever had to do that, probably.
I just the biggest thing that I took from that was just seeing him. That crowd was very hostile, and you know, for a guy who, you know, he doesn't get the chance anymore, but people would be like, oh, you can't wrestle. You know what? That dude went in there and worked his ass off in the most hostile of environments, an environment that you won't see nowadays at all ever again, environments that hadn't been seen since probably the 80s. And he drew some
emotion, too. Try that these days.
Exactly. So that's why I liked it. So, yeah.
Well, here's another question. What do you think really would have happened if he won?
I told you last week, or maybe I didn't know, that fucking building would have been burned down.
Bro, they would have been in the ring.
If you think there were riots in the 80s, there would have been a riot at the Manhattan Center that night.
So if you're the booker, you got the mic to the referee's ear, and you see what's going on. Are you tempted to switch it in the ring and have Cena go over just to see what happens?
Fuck
yeah, yeah.
Just to see him riot?
Yeah,
that'd be badass.
Yeah, burn it down, brother.
No, I think they did the right thing. I wouldn't have gone that route. Fuck that. No. They did the right thing. Give that bitch to RVD and let's get out of here. I mean, All right, let's move on. I got another tweet at BigBadVader56. He is requesting a top 5 enhancement talent show. I remember my brother and I were known as legend makers. He calls himself Mulky Mania on Twitter. He said, man, you took Doc's role tonight, referring to last week's show. You rained the drizzling shits on Harper's picks.
Well, you did.
I didn't mean to. I'm sorry.
Yeah, Harper. So.
I think you really did hurt Harper's feelings last week.
Bro, did you hear how Harper was like, Doc, go to your number two. Doc,
right.
No, don't worry about it. Doc, go to your number two. No, that's okay. Doc, go to your number two.
That was wrong.
Hey, what do you think about that top 5, though, Doc? Top 5 enhancement talents.
Menace to society. List done. There you go. Special extra edition top 5 for tonight.
I'd like to do a top 5 on bitch-ass hoes. Doc Turner.
See, that's not funny. That's not even creative.
It is for me. What'd you say?
At least with the enhancement talent one, it's not going to, you know, it's not going to be fucking Ric Flair and the same fucking people just fucking repackaged.
Right, that's true, because I can tell you right now. I don't know. I might put Ric Flair in that
one. I was doing this list, and I was like, it's the same motherfuckers.
We're going to get to that in a second. Mine wasn't the same, though. I mean, I see why you would say that, though.
I don't think mine was necessarily the same.
I don't know. We'll see. I got a couple more shout-outs. We got at Martin Howell 71. He wanted to thank Bo James again for coming on the show. He said all three parts of his second appearance on Booking the Territory were great, and he enjoyed them. Then we got at Mike Skills Tim, which is the Tim Horner parody account. He says, tell that female heel Delicious, nice stripper name. My boys at Mullet of Morton at the Eye of Gibson, bang bitches named Delicious. You got anything to tell Mike Skills Tim, Doc?
Jip jiving, socialize. Whoa, did you see that? Whoa, lightning might strike. Whoa, did you see that?
You want to see the fastest gun in the West? You want to see it again? yeah. Tim Dombrova on Facebook.
Tell me again how it tasted when Buddy Landale stuck a nut-sweated check in your mouth.
That's
stuffed
nice.
That puppy down his throat. I got to say thanks, Tim Dombrova. I did get your email, and I'm going to hold off for a couple weeks. I plan on using it in a few weeks after a few shows drop. You know, that way we can use it to drum up interest in previous shows. And I also got the newspaper clipping with Doc Turner's real identity on it. I appreciate you sending me that, Tim, and we will share that on next week's show. So, but again,
my real identity? I haven't lied to anyone. My name is Doc Turner.
Sure.
Also known as Delicious.
So, Tim, I just want to tell you, yes, I will. We'll cover that next week, man. I got it written down along with the story for Fake Stan Lane. He made a funny joke about Sasha Banks, and I gotta say I respect you, Stan, for coming up with that one. That one was poppable. You definitely popped me. And then lastly, before we get into the show, Mullet of Morton, thank you for the recent PayPal donation. And then patrons, I want to thank Matt, Marty, Big Dog, Armando, Wayne, Twit Dust, just to name a few. Thank you for your patron membership. I appreciate it. Thanks for supporting the show. We're gonna keep on giving us those anybody out there listening, if you really like what we're doing, come on, sign up, become a patron. It's a buck or two a month. It got some exclusive benefits involved with it. Tell them, Harper, sign up.
You got your whole life to be an asshole. Take a day off, you know?
Go to mikemills.podbean.com and click the Become a Patron button at the top of the page.
Fucking $2, bro.
I know, man. I mean, you could spend that on a pizza. You can order pizza one night, and you've spent the whole year of patron membership right there, just on one pizza. So think about it like that. All right, Harper.
Hey, I got a question though. How are we gonna cash in Morton's donation of an 8-ball? What's the cash equivalent for that these days?
I don't know. I don't. I've never bought an 8-ball, Doc. Maybe you have. Could you enlighten us?
Not recently, so I don't know, again, what the 2017 value would be.
I have no clue. So, yeah, I don't know what to tell you. Stop insulting Mullet to Morton. I mean, come on, man. All right, Hopper. You watched the Royal Rumble, some of it, didn't you?
I watched it from John Cena on.
Okay. So, let me tell you what I thought, and I want to tell you, and then I want you to tell me what you thought. So, I thought Cena and AJ was fine. I had no problem.
Yeah.
I mean, I knew Cena was going to win. I mean, that was pretty damn obvious, plain as day. Did you agree with that?
I didn't know, because I haven't watched it in forever. I mean, I didn't know he fucking AJ Styles was still the champion. So, I mean, fuck, I don't know. I was just, I enjoyed it, you know. I wish they would have sold more, but, you know, whatever. But, I mean, for the most part, it was an entertaining match.
Yeah, I agree. I liked it. It was entertaining. So you didn't see Owens and Roman Reigns then?
No.
Okay. I thought it was good, but I told Doc this because Doc didn't watch it. I said, if you're going to hit someone with some brass knuckles, two things need to happen. That motherfucker needs to be knocked out cold, and he better be bleeding everywhere. And Doc, what did you say about the hepatitis?
Gotta let the hepatitis flow freely.
Yeah.
Set that shit free.
Yeah, because he fucking clocked him with brass knuckles, and not only did it not knock him out, and not only did he kick out, but...
From the brass knuckles?
Yes! Roman Reigns kicked out from brass... That's what... Dude, when Jericho... Because Jericho was above the ring in the yeah. Shark Tank, in the cage, uh-huh. Right? So he dropped the knucks down, and Owens ends up clocking him with the knucks, and it... Legit brass knucks. And sure enough, Roman Reigns took a great bump. I mean, he took a fabulous bump on it. When Owens hit him, he fucking flew back like he'd been, you know, knocked out with a baseball bat or brass knucks, as you have it. But he kicked out, and then I'm like, okay, please have some blood, cause you know, dude, you hit somebody with some brass knuckles, you go open them up, and there's nothing, just you know, nothing. Yeah,
that's fine. I mean, whatever, bro. I mean, that's one of the reasons why I just can't sit through it.
Yeah. I will say this, and I texted Doc this because he had texted me during the pay-per-view. He said, how is it? And I saw Denim Fritz 605 on Twitter tweet this. Because I've been passively watching WWE for, you know, over a month now and not really as focused. I mean, I have it on in the background, but I'm not, like, watching it, taking notes like we used to.
I don't even have that anymore.
It was okay to watch it like that. Because I hadn't been watching it on Monday nights. It was like, okay, I'm not as burnt out. But at the end of the day, I mean, it's still the same product. It's not, you know,
yeah.
they showed me that on Monday and Tuesday with Raw and SmackDown when they pinned a lot of champions again. So, yeah, it is what it is.
And that's Hopper, one thing I noticed when you watch Smoky Mountain Wrestling, how many times have they a champion's fucking lost? I don't think I've seen them lose ever.
There is one coming up. I don't know what episode it is. I think it's in the
spoiler alert. Shut up.
Where a champion does get pinned in a non-title. But again, let's for the sake of argument say that's episode 35 of Smoky Mountain Wrestling. That means that we are almost we're pretty much 7 months in to Smoky Mountain. 8 months in before you ever see that. Let me tell you, on Raw this week, they did it a few times, and on SmackDown. So in two shows, they did it 6 times. So,
Yeah.
I'll give you a pass if you do it once like Smoky Mountain did, whatever episode that is that's coming up. But, yeah, man, it's bullshit. You can't just keep pinning your champs like that. I mean, Monday night, Jericho lost in a non-title match. In a mixed tag match, Charlotte got pinned clean. I guess, I kind of wanted to ask y'all about that. If you're a champion and you get pinned in a tag match, is that still the same thing? I don't remember that happened when I was younger. No?
No.
Okay. Doc, what about you?
It's not great, but it's more forgivable.
Yeah.
Right. That's kind of how I felt. It's kind of like more forgivable. So So Charlotte got pinned, and Cena got pinned in a tag match. Now, Cena gets pinned in a tag match the night after he won the title and 16-time world champion. But anyway, just to make that point. Alexa Bliss, who's your Raw Women's Champion, she got pinned, too, in a tag match. But we cap it off, SmackDown last night, Dean Ambrose, your Intercontinental Champion, loses to AJ Styles clean. So
is AJ Styles the champion?
No, he pinned the IC champ clean.
So he's the Intercontinental Champion.
No, then. It was non-title.
Huh.
Yeah.
Huh.
So anyway, So while I was optimistic and I actually enjoyed watching the Rumble on Sunday night, it was not bad. There was nothing else on TV for one. I sat down and I just still, you know, I tune in on Monday and I start seeing champions get pinned and SmackDown on Tuesday, champions getting pinned. And I'm like, okay, here we go again with this shit. But anyway, so that's my feelings. And then, Doc, I know you did not watch any of it. Harper, did you catch any? You saw the – Harper, let me tell you. Harper texted me at 10:30, two words, Samoa Joe, on Monday night. I was sleeping. I missed it, actually. I didn't see it till the next day.
Yeah.
So I don't know. I'm kind of optimistic on that because Samoa Joe is there, but we'll see what happens.
I think he hurt him. Didn't he hurt his knee?
Seth, yeah, that's the reports that Seth is hurt. I haven't heard any like confirmation on how bad it is. I heard he's hurt. I just don't know if.
I heard they needed Triple H out there to get Samoa Joe over.
That motherfucker. That's why I went to bed. Triple H got out there, and I saw him walk into the ring. And that promo went on and on and on and on and on and on. And I just couldn't take it. I went to bed. I was like, I can't listen to this stupidity. You know, because in his mind, he thinks he had to go out there and do that. I had somebody on Twitter, and I'm sorry I don't remember who it was, but tweeted me and said, Triple H is the most insecure person who feels like he has to justify his position, in that has a great position. I don't know if I'm saying that right, but like he's got this great position with the company, but he's still insecure. So he's got to go out there and do that.
He's gonna bury Samoa Joe down in Orlando in a couple of months. You watch.
Jesus, don't let's not. All right, we'll move on. So I got a question. We had a female listener. We begin some female questions.
Hey, yeah, what's up?
What's up, girl?
Listener. Nicole is her name. She says, have you
Nikki.
Ever...
Nikki Bella.
No, she just says Nicole. Have you ever thought of talking about Lucha Underground on the show? I enjoy the classic wrestling stuff, but Lucha is episodic and entertaining. It exceeds that WWE shit you guys hate. Anyway, love the shows and even the excessive motherfuckers and bitches and shit. That was
well, if you
email.
Like that... If you're going to like that, I hope that you turn off the podcast and get back in the kitchen and make some sandwiches.
Oh, fuck.
Nicole.
She did go on to say, Hard Body Hopper's voice is very, very sexy. I like
bro,
that.
Bro, she wants
him.
It, bro.
She might be Walmart scooter thick, though, man.
Nah.
Not Nicole, no.
Nah.
No?
Nah. No, I doubt it.
Why?
Send me a picture.
She emails. I don't have a picture. It's not on Facebook. I don't know what she looks like. She's not like. And now, so Amy was. So you don't do Walmart scooter trick like Amy, but Nicole, you can take.
Yeah, well, she's probably a very nice girl.
Okay. Well, just to make a statement about Lucha Underground, Doc, you said you gave it a try when it first came on TV because you have the El Rey Network, right?
That is correct.
And you hated it.
Really?
I didn't get it. And part of it is that there's a couple of things. I got a lot of respect for what luchadors do, but that doesn't mean I want to watch it. And they also were doing some intergender matches, and I'm not a real big fan of that either.
I love that channel, dude. I wish I had it. 'Cause that channel is like what TNT was like 20, 25 years ago when they show like all those stupid Schwarzenegger movies and you know fucking Mad Max.
Lots of old kung fu movies.
Yeah, they show like all that old cheesy shit and I mean I watched it once. I mean I didn't hate it. I mean, God, the fucking chicks in there are so fucking fine, bro. God. It was like wrestling porn.
Harper had his lubrication out as he was sitting in his room watching it.
Yeah.
Well, rumor has it today, I saw it on Twitter, and I still can't confirm it from a verifiable source, although I've been told that MLW has mentioned it, that it is going to be on Netflix coming February the 15th. So, if it is, I'm going to give it a try. I actually gave it a try, but it was on the Spanish channel in the Dallas-Fort Worth area, Season 1. And while I speak a little bit of Spanish... you know, because I studied it in school, Doc, you know what I'm saying? While working towards my undergrad, I studied Spanish, you know what I'm saying? So I can speak a little, but not enough to fully understand what's going on, and it's so episodic that you really have to have a grasp of what's going on. So I'm going to give it a try.
So what you're saying is, Matt Stryker's Spanish is too advanced for you?
Yeah.
No. Have you watched the Spanish version of it? With Vampiro and the other announcer? Matt Stryker's not on the Spanish version of it. Fucking dumbass.
Well, then I'm out.
Yeah, so, I'm going to give it a try. If it truly is coming to Netflix, I'll give it a try. And, Nicole, who knows? Maybe we'll talk about it a little bit. But, you know, because
I'd rather talk about Nicole.
I'm for anything I am for anything that tells stories and is episodic, unlike what I see a lot of times. Or tells terrible stories like what I see a lot of times at WWE these days. All right, Doc,
I know they kill somebody on Lucha Underground in the storylines.
Well, see, there you go. So it's not really wrestling, but it's not really like a, I guess
it is. Like, fucking know it. It's like those Spanish soap operas. That's what it reminds me of.
Telenovelas.
Yeah. They had one guy on there that like used to be a dragon. And now he's a man, and I was like, the fuck is this shit?
I just spent a year reviewing Trick or Treat or Delete and Total Nonstop Deletion. Maybe I should go back and watch Lucha Underground.
I think you should and give it a chance. Yeah. I really do. All right, we got an email from Jason. Jason is the one who's got his wife listening to the show now, Doc. Jason wanted to say, he said, another great show this week. Doc, my taste in women is the same as you. I was actually born at Arlington Memorial Hospital. I'm a few years younger than you guys, but I was able to appreciate World Class, mainly because of my dad. Doc, do you remember the Fort Worth shows would end in the middle of the main event many weeks, and you would have to tune into the next week just to find out what happened? God damn, it sucked you in. Because it was a great match going on, but you were glued to the TV, and then you had to sit back and wait next week to find out what happened at the ending. He says he lived in Midlothian until 89. Doc could explain where that
was.
This week's Impact, and he went on to talk about it. He said, this week's Impact wasn't too bad. The main event was a pleasant surprise. You had Bobby Lashley winning the title back. The ending was starting to look like a tap out with a few seconds left was going to happen and piss me off, but they didn't do it, thank goodness. The Knockouts match was pretty good, too. I have to agree, Jason. The reason I didn't talk about Impact at the top of the show, I thought Rosemary and Jade killed each other in that Impact fucking match. I mean, that was pretty intense. So I liked Impact last week. But, Doc, you got any comments on our longtime listener, Jason, who told me last week he is going to sign up to become a patron?
Great, but I'm tired of talking about his past. Let's talk about his wife.
Okay. What?
He did say his wife loves when we talk about how
well, all women like when they get talked about. So there you go. And with two women back to back, this is turning into. Well, I won't say that.
Say it.
I can't. So anyway, it is.
Very classy.
I'm turning over. New year, new me. You know. That Fort Worth show on Saturday night, man, you'd sit around there watching that shit for 2 hours. The Von Erichs would come out about 6 minutes into it. They go, we got to go. I'd be like, motherfucker.
They did it every week, too. I mean, Mid-South was the same way. You'd be in the middle of the end of the show, and the shit's hitting the fan. And we'd be back next week, everybody. We got to go now. We're out of TV time. You're like,
But I guarantee you that if that dude lived in Midlothian until 1989, there's at least 13% chance that he's had sexual relations with a farm animal.
That's nice.
What?
Hey, you know what? people can get offended, but somewhere right now, Jason's going, man, I was from there, and he's right.
No, Jason, don't listen to him. He's playing heel. We got to move
so
on.
Let's get, let's get it to wrestling, because we got a new champion in TNA. Bobby Lashley regained the title. That was good. That show was all right. I mean, it's average. I'm still waiting for Dutch and Jarrett to get involved. That was a pretty good show. What about ROH, man? That was a good show they ran last week.
I thought it was fine. I mean, you know, but I'm going to tell you this because I want to get some clicks on my report. Go to pwtorch.com and click on the ROH hits and misses column. You can hear all about it. No, seriously, because I could talk about that for another 45 minutes. I thought ROH did a good job last week, man.
I didn't know who that Juice Robinson dude was. I enjoyed watching him. Go read about Mike fucking blowing him in some article or some shit.
What?
Whatever. Go to pwtorch.com. Check out my ROH hits and misses. You know, we're starting to run a little bit longer right now. We need to get to our top five. But, yeah, go check it out because I did a – again, I'm doing the weekly reviews of ROH TV. So pwtorch.com, and it's called ROH Hits and Misses. You'll see it on there. Click the Opinions and Analysis tab, I think is what it's called, at the very top of the page.
Click the Marks and Jabronis tab at the top of the page. You'll find minutes first up.
Floyd had a question. Thanks, Doc. I appreciate that, man. Who's writing for PW Torch? That's what I thought. Floyd had a question. He said, did you hear how Kerry cut himself at Super Clash 3? Embry says that Kerry was putting on his robe when he sliced himself. I think I might have talked about this a couple weeks ago, but yeah.
Yes.
Yeah, that's what I heard. That sounded crazy. He said they had meat hanging out. God.
Is that what he said on the podcast?
Yes. Mm-hmm. He said like he like sliced it open and there was like fucking meat hanging out.
Oh, shit.
He said the word meat.
Yeah.
I didn't realize he said meat. Okay.
Uh-huh.
God damn. Fuck that.
Cocaine's a hell of a drug.
Fuck, man. Yeah. And that was the thing, because if you ever listen to Lawler, he talks about how during that match, he goes, I don't understand, you know, I don't know about the speculation about Kerry was on something, but I can tell you one thing. When we were in that match, he was on it. He was there. Like, his point was Kerry was not, like, flying around and you know, unable to compete, so to say. So I thought that was pretty telling, even though, you know, supposedly Kerry may have been on something. Who knows? I think, Doc, you need to say allegedly. You need to back
it up. Oh, allegedly. Allegedly.
Thank you. All right, Brady had a question. He said, man, I listened to the first Tony Schiavone show. They briefly mentioned the old WCW Cruiserweight title. Schiavone said he hated having so many different titles because it made the world title mean that much less. Brady went on to say, I believe all three of the BTT Army, hashtag BTT Army on Twitter, has said that the WWE has way too many titles for a very long time. Doc, I never thought about it like this. Besides the fact that the WWE shits on titles all the time, like we've discussed earlier in the show, but Shivani's got a point. If you got 50 million titles, that kind of devalues your titles, right? Because everybody can be a champion?
I don't know.
It's like the boxing.
I don't know.
Title.
They had a.
There's so many fucking boxing champions.
That is a problem in boxing. I agree.
Yeah.
We used to have the Texas heavyweight champion. You had a United States champion, a TV champion, the tag champions. Hell, back in the day, there was a. In the NWA, there was the World Tag Team Champs and the United States Tag Team Champs. I'm more of an opinion that how you treat the belts is more important than and write those stories than how many you have. But they got one too many world titles in WWE, so there's that.
I don't know, man. I look at it a little bit differently. I think across the NWA, because you had the territory system. Yeah, you may have had – and that the U.S. tag titles weren't around forever. So let's not overstate the fact that we're talking about they were in existence.
And the three-man tag belts.
Yeah, I mean, you had some titles that had short runs. I mean, I was okay back in the day. You know, I'll even toot WWE's horn here, WWF. I was okay when you had the world title and you had the IC title and then you had the tag belts. I feel like that was the only belts they had for a while. I could be wrong because I'm not a WWF expert. So I can kind of see why Schiavone said that. Now, again, Schiavone was mentioning that in relation to the Cruiserweight title because, you know, they had gotten to the point where they had the world title, they had the U.S. title, which had been around for a while. You had the tag belts, you had the Cruiser. Woman's belt, And then you were introducing a cruiser. So I kind of understand why Shivani was saying that. Did you really need a cruiserweight title at that time?
No.
I don't know.
Did you really need
to throw on the luchadors?
Right. Or the smaller guys. I agree.
Right.
What'd you say, Doc?
I was just wondering if the Gulf Coast Wrestling needed tag team titles back in 2000. You tell me.
What does that have to do with what we're talking about related to the cruiserweight title? Besides you making a lame fucking joke.
Who made the pin? You were Bishop Steel.
Bishop Steel. What's he doing now?
Do you know who that is, Harper?
I have no clue. Who is that?
He was an old buddy of mine. He's still around. He was older too. He was an older dude.
Well, like Bishop Aluminum.
You're stupid. But yeah, man. Anyway, I've actually heard that joke before. That's why I just chuckled a little bit. Someone actually told him that one time in the back. All right. So I agree with Shivani. I don't know if the cruiserweight title was they really needed it. But if you look at that by comparison to what is going on now in WWE, shit, that looks like nothing compared to all the goddamn titles WWE has these days.
And now they got the UK belt.
They got everything. It's like bowl games, like you said a few weeks ago. All right, one more question for our top five. Another one, this is from Connor. He says, on the recent Tony Schiavone episode, seems like Tony Schiavone's podcast is pretty popular. On the fall of 1998 house shows, Goldberg asked for off, and it was approved by J.J. Dillon. But WCW kept promoting Goldberg versus the Giant. They ended up having to refund thousands of tickets, and that blunder cost the company over $11,000. Vonnie made the point, at a normal job, people lose their job for mistakes like this. And then Connor goes on to say, also, Tony mentions WCW Thunder. Tony said, if you want to point out to any one thing that is the downfall of WCW, it's WCW Thunder. Doc, I got a question. We talk about this all the time when it comes to corporate America. More is more is more is more mentality. Does that shock you when Tony Schiavone makes a statement like that about Thunder? And we've heard this about Thunder before, but I just got to ask that question for you.
No, it doesn't surprise me. I haven't heard the podcast yet, but what does surprise me is that motherfucker likes to say the word motherfucker. And it's just weird to think of Tony Schiavone using the word fuck a lot.
Yeah, I can't see him cursing.
Have you heard the podcast?
No.
I never
knew we had one.
It just debuted this week on Sunday or Monday. I went and downloaded it after I started getting questions from people. And then, like I said, I got to listen to this, obviously, to know what the hell I'm talking about. And I am shocked that Tony Schiavone says motherfucker as much as me, it seems.
Foul mouth motherfucker.
Did you listen to it, Doc?
It ain't hit iTunes yet, so I can't fucking download it.
That's bullshit. It's on iTunes.
It's
on MLW
it.
Radio. You're full of bullshit. You fucking listen to it. You just don't want to comment on it. Fucking cocksucking bitch.
Wow.
Yeah, wow. All right.
You and Tony Schiavone have dirty mouths.
All right, let's get into the top five. But before I do so, I just want to say, make sure you're on our Facebook page. That's facebook.com/bookingtheterritory. And then click the Shop Now button while you're there. And
we need you to buy a T-shirt and then shut the fuck up and then get the fuck out.
He's on mute, and he's just like, what the fuck, man?
Stop being an asshole.
Yeah.
Stop being an asshole.
I got a 5-star review on iTunes about that, too, how I need to edit it better because of when Harper mutes himself. Harper, say it. Buy a what?
Buy a fucking T-shirt.
There we go. So on the Facebook page, facebook.com/bookingtheterritory, click the Shop Now button, buy a T-shirt, buy two T-shirts, buy three of them, and then follow us on Twitter at @BTT_podcast. I'm at Mike504Saints. Hardbody Harper and all his bitches are at CJHWhoDat on Twitter. So, and then do us one more favor. On Facebook, hit the share button when we post the shows. Turn on your notifications on Twitter and hit the retweet button when we post the shows. I can guarantee you about 95% of the new listeners find the show because of shares and retweets. So please, please share it, retweet the show. Let's get on to the top five sellers in pro wrestling history now. All right. Doc, why don't you start first this week, man?
Okay.
Who's your number five number one or in your well, top listen, five or so.
Let's do a little something for the people out there that may not have flat back bumped like the two of you geniuses have. Can you set the stage for the people on why selling is maybe what the vital importance it plays to the wrestling angle in the match and why you guys think it's a dying art these days?
Well, I mean, I'm sure Harper will agree. If you don't sell the move or sell punches or sell anything being done to you, it's a fucking work. So you got to sell it to make it believable. I mean,
right. It's like what I tell them. It's like, just because this shit's fake don't mean it's got to fucking look like it.
Right. So the art of selling is making that person, whether they're in the front row or, you know, sitting up in the nosebleeds at the Louisiana Superdome, you want that person to know that, damn, that motherfucker just took a shot. Shit.
Yeah.
This shit might be fake, but that fucking dude got rocked. You know, that's what you want.
Get your face up.
Yeah. And I remember, I've heard this from a few people. I want to say maybe Tommy Rogers told me this one time. I could be wrong, but I remember being told, man, when you're selling, sell to the back row. And it wasn't like the person wasn't saying, like, look to the back row. It's just like, make sure when you sell, you know, you're selling so that the person who, that can barely see you can see that you're selling. You know, so, it means everything in pro wrestling.
I just wanted a little in-depth wrestling talk because we got a lot of females out there. You know, they're like, I like the part when they talk shit about people, but I don't like it when they talk wrestling. So I thought maybe it was time for y'all to talk some wrestling on these with all these girls listening.
Well, I mean, if you listen to Hopper, he said Sonny didn't sell in her porno, and that was part of
the
problem.
She didn't sell that. She just took it.
So Sonny's not on your list tonight.
No, she just went through the spot. She's a fucking spot monkey. She just kept on going. Just like, is it over yet? Is this the finish?
Pin me, baby. she hit pin me, baby.
Yeah.
Hopper. Sonny didn't sell nothing. She was just a spot monkey.
Yeah, she's just sitting there. Oh, yeah, huh, yeah, right there. Yeah, huh, God. Yeah, yeah.
I love when he does that. All right, Doc, let's get to it. You're number five, man.
My number five is Dolph Ziggler.
Right.
Fuck, that's mine.
Your kid. So,
you see? I told y'all. It's the same. Yeah. I got number five. It's fucking Dolph Ziggler.
He's getting all swole up in the chest, dude.
Sorry, Harper. Goddamn.
Yeah, damn, shit.
I think we can work around this. I'll say a little bit about Dolph, and then I'll hand off to you. I think Dolph just does a great job. I think he's criminally underrated. I think more than half the guys on the roster could take a cue and watch his matches. I the one thing with Dolph I can't figure out, and I don't watch anymore, but when I used to watch him, is I couldn't figure out if he's overselling or if everybody else just doesn't know how to sell on the roster. I never could get that figured out. So anyway, I'll go with Dolph Ziggler at five and pass it over to Harper.
Yeah, it's just no one else sells. I mean, they sell. It seems like they sell enough to where like they won't get bitched at, but he sells like you're supposed to sell. I mean, that's like what I was telling the guys at Wildcat. He makes everything look like a finisher. So if he takes a body slam, it looks like he's really fucked up. And 9 times out of 10, when you watch it now, someone takes a body slam, it's fucking nothing. They just jump right back up. I mean, they don't even attempt to sell the back. I mean, whatsoever. And I think he's one of those guys where, let's say like 20, 30 years from now, he'll still be there as a instructor. So
he needs to be. I agree, Harper. He's a hell of a. He's not in my list. I mean, I'll let that spoiler out now. But nobody's. If you're talking about current wrestlers,
yeah.
Man, nobody sells like Dolph, man.
For real.
Dolph sells everything. I mean, he even sells. Like when he, how can I say it? When he pulls off a move, like when it's him delivering a move to somebody, he sells that and initiates the contact, and he makes that. He actually sells offensive moves even better than anybody. It's hard to explain, but Dolph is good, man. And they've, you know, the sad part is they've shit on him.
Yep.
They shit all over Dolph.
And then it's he just takes him with a shit-eating grin.
I mean, maybe he's just pin me. You know, he's probably like, pin me, pay me, boss, which, you know, hey, more power to him. But, yeah, man, Dolph is great. I didn't think to put Dolph in mind, but listening to you all, you're right. Harper, you hit it, too, because he takes a body slam, he sells his back. Anything he takes, clotheslines, anything, he's selling it. Headlock, yeah. Dolph's a hell of a seller. Hell of a seller. I agree. Mm-hmm. Doc, you're actually going to like my number five. You know why?
No.
Okay. Always got to wait a second because you're fucking... Your responses are always super delayed. I put Ric Flair as my number five.
Number five?
Top seller of all time, yeah.
Right.
Yeah, I did.
We need to get you drug tested.
Well, it's because I think the people I have ahead of him are actually better sellers. We've said it many times.
All right, we can just start skipping you. Harper and I will give the people.
No,
yeah.
You're gonna listen to me.
Your list has now been invalidated.
No, it's not. Rick, for me, he could work a match with a broomstick. You've all heard that a million times. He is the multi-time world champion just because he's not just that world champion a million times because of his promos. He could get in the ring, go through each and every territory in the 80s and make everyone he got in that ring with look like $1 million.
Rick ought to pour himself into his Cadillac, drive across 7 or 8 states, and hit you with that broomstick, you dumb motherfucker.
Mm-mm. Rick did a lot of things. I mean, let me guess. You're going to have him as number one. I guarantee you there's people on my list you're like, yeah, they were a better seller. Which I'll go to my number four.
Maybe you should.
Bret Hart.
God.
Bret was a great seller because he could tell a story in a ring just by selling.
Yeah. I have him as like an honorable mention. You can't disagree with that.
Now, see, Harper, you got him as an honorable mention. Doc won't have him in his top five because he just don't like Bret. He hates Bret. He thinks Bret.
He hates
got a
WWE.
Problem with Bret. Well, yeah. But that, I mean, you know, Bret's exempt from WWE hate in my eyes. Because he's that good. So, yeah, I had to go with Bret. Bret could tell a story in a ring. Bret was a good promo, not a great promo, if you think about it. So, you know, but when he got in the ring, his ability to sell and make other people look great, he was right there, up there with the best of them. So I had to go with Bret for number four. All right, Doc, Harper, you're number four.
My number four is Kirk Hennin, Mr. Perfect.
I got a feeling he's going to be on some list.
Yeah. So he sold everything like he was really fucking hurting. He would sell it because I was watching some old stuff. And I just watched him sell his knee. And it seems like he would always get that damn hurt knee in every damn match. And it just, I don't know. It's just something that you just don't see anymore. And I hate it that it's gone. And I guess it's like fucking no one gives a shit.
It's just a different world these days when it comes to wrestling. When it comes to wrestling.
But it shouldn't be.
Oh, it shouldn't be. I agree.
It should. It's fucking dumb to not sell.
Give me an example of Luke at the school when the boys ain't selling while they're practicing. I can hear
it. Right. They fucking take a strike. It'll be like we have like a guy that Josh. He's like. He used to play at fucking Nickel State. He's like, you know, fucking 6'3". He could probably bench press a fucking Buick, and he's punching like someone that's like half his size, and they just I was like, what the fuck you doing, bro? What the fuck you doing? He's fucking twice your size, man. Sell that shit.
He needs to be looking like he's murdering you.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Stop the murder on TV.
It just pisses me off. But yeah, it's just I had Kirk Hennin because he was someone that just really, he was one of those top guys that just did everything right.
Yeah, Kurt sold everything. That's no. Like, man, Kurt was awesome. Definitely. All right, Doc, you're number four.
I had Hennin at six, and I had a real hard time not putting him five, but I wanted to give Dolph some shine because I think he deserves it. But Hennin could have easily been in the list as well for me. My number four may surprise you guys because I am going to go to somebody who spent a lot of time in the WWE or WWF. I'm going to go with Randy Macho Man Savage at number 4.
Yeah, I'll take that.
Yeah, you can't. I don't think anybody can argue that.
That guy would also sell things like the elbow drop, and he would kind of sell that. He had the damn wrapped arm in WCW for like a year.
I remember that.
Yeah, I mean, he just did that grimace with that he could really work a grimace. You talk about selling things. I don't think anybody was selling their promos quite like he was. He was kind of on another planet when it comes to that. You know, the whole thing was wrapped in the Macho Man's persona. He was selling it was more than just selling moves. He was really selling the whole thing. But that guy could jump around. He was athletic, and he could really sell and make you believe that he was in a legitimate contest where he was being injured. I'm going to go with Macho Man at number 4. Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Brother, I appreciate that, Doc. Nah, you're right. He could sell. He could, like you said, he just couldn't. He sold it in the ring, and, like, he was believable. Even when he was cutting those promos and sounding crazy, you're like, fuck, that motherfucker really looks like he could rip somebody's head off. And it made you respected him because of that. So, yeah, I would agree. All right, where are we up to, number 3? Go ahead, Doc.
You know how sometimes you watch games like and you want your quarterback, like you guys for Breeze back in the day with me, Roma. You're like, you'd see him get hit or something. You're like, please don't be hurt. Please don't be hurt. Please don't be hurt. Please don't be hurt. Right? Mm-hmm. We've all done that.
Yeah.
My number 3 is the wrestling equivalent of that as he got older. Mine is number 3 is Terry Funk. The guy would continue to take abuse well into his 50s and maybe even into his 60s. He was doing things, and you would just seem like even ECW get a move put on, and he'd scream out, or he'd be like, son of a bitch, and just the way he did it. But you can go all the way back to when he, like, you know, and I know he's got an NWA run in the 70s, which is ridiculous to say as well, but, like, go back to that 89 I Quit match with Flair, and he sticks in the figure four to make him quit, and that he submits Funk on that, and he's yelling, oh, my knee, you're breaking my leg. I mean, just really putting the touches to it. He's a guy who would sell, like, I think Funk would sell his punches like it was really hurting his hand. Just the little touches of things that, you know, Funk is, and he's a wild man, but it's the consummate professional. We've alluded to it with other guys. It's the craft of putting on an entire show and an entire work to people, and I just think that he sold things. He probably was the best seller for the longest period of time of anybody we'll have on this these lists.
Yeah, because his career went forever.
that's putting it mildly.
Yeah. I mean, heck, it's still going, I guess. I mean, he's probably had more retirements than anyone, but.
I don't want to give away too many spoilers, but it's a motherfucker when you see him do a moonsault in the Knoxville Coliseum on Bob Armstrong in a year or so.
Well, not only that, but when you see him do it then in ECW.
Well, this would have been prior to ECW.
That's what I'm saying. He does it after, so meaning he was even older when he did it in ECW. Is my point. Like for his career going forever. So, yeah, Funk was a hell of a seller. I will agree. Not on my list, but. Definitely. What was your 3, Harper?
Ric Flair, man. The Nature Boy.
Yeah.
Yeah. It seemed like it didn't matter who we wrestled against. He made him look good.
He did.
It didn't matter who or what level they were. If they were just, you know, some fucking a mid-card guy or they were a main eventer. He made him look good because he would sell for him.
I mean, you've heard it on every podcast there is. Like, and I make fun of Rick nowadays, not drunk he can get. But, man, there was a reason that Rick held that belt back then for so long and so many multiple times. Like, you know, they trusted him going around to those freaking promotions and throughout the territory to go in there. Make the freaking hero look like $1 million, but still, you know, him come out with the win. And damn, you're right, man. He worked with so many people, made him look strong, made him look great, that it's hard to articulated now to a current wrestling fan.
Yeah.
I would agree. My number three, moving right along, Harper, you just said it, Curt Hennig. I mean, I've heard, the only argument I've heard about Curt is, like, his selling sometimes was, like, over the top.
But, yeah.
But I liked it. I mean, you knew he was getting his ass kicked. That was the thing about Curt. But you got to admit, Harper, he would take some regular clotheslines and make it look like somebody just decapitated
him. He would flip all over the place.
So did Shawn Michaels, though, for that matter.
Yeah.
Yeah, Shawn did. Actually, I always –
Shawn Michaels.
I actually always thought that Shawn got it from Curt.
Yeah, I think so, too.
Like, in my mind – you know what I'm saying? In my mind, I'm like, he was – I don't know if that's what he was doing, but in my mind, I'm thinking, okay, he's doing what Kurt was doing. But Kurt is hell, dude. There's videos. There was one I was watching a couple months back, and I forget who Kurt was working, but he's on the outside, and it's in WWF, and he just gets like he gets punched, and he does like a fucking backflip on just a punch. I'm like, shit, dude, what the hell did he hit you with? Did he have something in that hand? But Kurt was pretty he was over the top, but I'm not complaining. I still enjoyed it. Shoulder tackles, anything, a regular punch, a clothesline, anything that Kurt got hit with, it looked like somebody blasted a cannonball at his ass and knocked him silly. So he was my three. Okay, so that leaves us with we're up to two. My two, I think I'm gonna get some heat for this one, but I'm gonna say it, is Ricky Morton. Yes, I know I said two, but hear me out. Morton could sell his ass off. He would have the fans wanting to charge the ring, get after whoever was dishing it out. You know, and he's one half of the greatest tag team of all time with Robert Gibson. So, I don't know. Ricky, I could probably make an argument for putting him number one, but he's my number two, and he is definitely one of the greatest sellers ever. So, that was my number two. Harper, you want to go to your two?
I got Shawn Michaels. That's my number two. And I was watching that freaking match with Hogan he did like 10 years ago.
That was
he's flopping around. Yeah. I was like, look at this shit. Like, he's like a fucking fish that someone threw like on the deck of a boat.
He took that boot and made almost a 360 loop around the ring when he took that shit.
So, dude, that shit was hilarious.
That was so over the top. Harper said it best. He looked like a fish that was like on a fishing pier or on a wharf that was just flopping around. You're like, let me ask y'all a question about that, because, and I don't have any inside knowledge, I'm just curious. Do y'all think he was like almost doing that as a rib?
Yes.
That's what they said, yeah. I mean,
I think it was, is that if I'm going to have to lose to Hogan or put up with this bullshit, I'm going to make it cartoony and.
Yeah.
The message.
So here's another question to follow up on that then. Do you think that,
because let me tell you something, do I think what?
Oh, I'm asking Harper. Let me keep hold your thought, Doc, because I want to hear. Do you think if that was a rib and Shawn was just doing that just to be a prick, do you think that was unprofessional of him?
To sell like that? No. Nah.
He flopped around the Harper.
Yeah.
It was egregious, dude.
That shit was hilarious.
Go ahead, Doc. What were you going to say?
It would be unprofessional if it was anybody but Hogan. And I don't think that Shawn Michaels could ever be accused of being a pin me, pay me kind of guy.
Yeah, you know what? You got a point on that one. That is true. But, dude, Shawn... Oh, man. Harper, what? You said you just watched that match back?
Yeah, well, you know, I've seen it a million times, but I watched it yesterday. I was like, Jesus Christ. Yeah, here it is. We've been fucking flopping all over the place for, like, you know, a basic clothesline from a 60 fucking year old man.
I forget. It was so over the top. It was awesome. It was great. What year was that? Do you remember?
It was like 10 years ago.
I'm gonna go back and watch it. Y'all got me wanting
to
watch it.
Maybe
now.
I don't.
That's what I was thinking. He flopped around over. Wait, so when he took the what did he do where he just like went flying? Like, well,
it was the boot.
It was the boot.
Yeah.
Fucking Shawn Michaels. Oh, I lost my smile.
Yeah.
That was good, though. I like that one. That was a good match. Doc, who's your number two?
This isn't my number two, but have you seen the tag team? I think it's Orton and Flair versus Michaels and Triple H, where Triple H comes off the top and catches the boot and stands there for like a minute.
Yeah, I've seen that like a million times. He's just like standing there. Yeah, and he's like blowing at him to like knock him over.
Yes.
Yeah.
Do you know what I'm talking about there, Menace?
It's not coming to my memory right now. But what about it?
I was just wondering if you'd seen it.
I thought you were about to say something about it. No, I can't recall it. Can you send me a video clip of it? Because I'm sure if I see it, then I'll
try to find it.
It's like one of those matches, like when the camera stops rolling, and they have like the match afterwards. I think it's something like that from like 10 years ago or something.
Okay.
And apparently it was done as like a rib at Rick because Rick would oversell, so Triple H was good. And he stands there, and I'm not over exaggerating. It's 45 seconds or a minute on a jumping off the top and a boot to the face. Where I just thought that would be the Triple H would be your number one seller of all time based on that.
Hell no.
All right, well, my number two is Rock and Roll Baby, Ricky Morton.
Wow.
Playing Ricky Morton is a thing, so I mean, shit. Babyface in Peril, he was the guy that set it all up for Gibson to come in for the tag. Making, you know, people used to say that when he was selling, that the girls would be crying in the audience because they really thought that Ricky was getting hurt. So that's believability right there, and I'm ready to see some of that come to life in the Smoky Mountains, if you know what I mean.
You know what's funny about Morton? A lot of people don't, well, not just Morton, but like selling. Man, it takes a lot of energy when you're getting your ass kicked like that to sell in a ring. I don't think a lot of people realize that. They think you're just like laying there or just not really working hard, but it takes a lot of energy to be as good of a seller in a ring like that. Would you agree?
And not lose the people.
Well, right. Not lose the people, but just to not get winded too.
As Luke would say, you're not fucking dead.
Right, you're not just laying there.
Yeah.
You know, you're not just laying on your back, just like, okay, whip my ass. It actually takes energy to go through the motions of selling, and that was what was amazing about Morton. Man, I can remember NWA matches where it felt like Morton sold for 20 minutes straight, just ass whipping. Now, he'd come to life every now and then. But to your point,
the other two guys were tagging out every 35 seconds.
Well, true, but, I mean, I'm just saying, he would never die, though. He would never die on the heels, but he would never get enough energy to where he can make the tag to Gibson until, you know, they got well into the match. That was when tag team wrestling was great. But yeah, that was those were those days, man. And Morton was up there with the best of them. Doc, we're here. We're at your number one. Let us have it.
The greatest seller in the history of professional wrestling is the Nature Boy Ric Flair.
Okay.
He made every one of your local heroes. He made you think that this is the time. I know he's not going to, but this is the time. This is the time. I remember when he won the title again in the mid to, like, 96. He'd be on Saturday night. I'd get mad because he'd fight, like, I remember one match. He fought Alex Wright, the Wonderkin. And I was like, why is he giving Alex Wright so much offense? He couldn't help it. He was just, he sold. That's what he did. That's who he was. I mean, he had a chop and a figure four and the setup moves for the figure four. And the turnbuckle going head first, and I know he didn't invent it, but then running, sprinting down to the other end and coming off and missing that. You know, he's never hit that in his life. He's got signature moves that allow him to sell that you recognize and know. And I say he's the greatest professional wrestler of all time. I agree with you guys that the art of selling is vitally important to the work. So if he's the greatest wrestler of all time, he needs to be the greatest seller of all time, and I think he is. So there you go.
I'm not surprised at that, Doc. I'm definitely not surprised at that at all. All right, Harper, what's your number one?
Ricky Morton, man.
Wow.
Yeah. Dude, I was watching some old shit, bro. It was this fucking – it was them versus the Barbarian, and I forgot who the other guy was.
Haku? Ming?
I can't remember. Dude, and it was just so great fucking watching them work. And just watching them sell. And those little girls, those fucking women were just screaming every time they would hit him. They would scream like he'd been shot by a fucking gun.
Right.
If you want to know what over is sometime, go pick up a rock and roll video of them biting somebody and don't even watch it. Just close your eyes and listen to the crowd.
Dude, really. Google that fucking shit. And every move, like he would get something in, a drop kick, they would scream their fucking heads off.
Yep.
And it's like, man, this is – that's how you do it.
Right. That's how you
that's
get
how
over.
That's how you do it. That's how you do it, man.
That's how you take an ass-whipping and get over.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was a badass with that. That's true about Morton, man. He'd have them he'd have them women. They'd be moist like a cake that just came out the oven, and they were
that's
hot,
nice.
Ready to go.
God. we are trying to cultivate a female audience. And,
Nicole don't want to hear that shit.
Man, women get hot too, just like dudes. Don't let them fucking fool you, shit.
Hear about them getting moist?
Them broads get moist, man.
I'm Catholic.
Broads. Really? Is that necessary?
I've been saying that word for years, man, and now Denim Fritz is using it on Twitter. And I got to give him credit for kindling that word up and making it a thing. So at DenimFritz605, man, thank you for always saying broads. But yeah, man, them broads were moist, man. They were ready for some Ricky
girls,
Morton.
I'm going to go ahead and tell you this, and I'm sure Nicole and Jason's wife and our other female listeners will. I think that women, there's a lot of dirty words that you would think that women would be offended up by. But moist in a lot of women's mind is actually a worse word than those. So I would prefer for the sake of our female listeners if you would stop using the word moist.
The next time I come to you to be the voice of reasoning on Booking the Territory will be the last time. So fuck you, Doc. No, I will not take any advice that you take.
I'm sorry to all my special ladies out there. I tried, but he's a problem, and I agree, and I see it.
You're a cocksucking prick, bitch.
I know, ladies. That's I'm working nice. For you and the Hispanic folks. So now you've alienated our ladies and our Hispanic population.
Where them Spanish chicks at? They're fucking listening? What's up, girl? I'll make you a citizen. Fuck that wall.
You could call it Harper Poppy by the end of the night.
Yeah.
I was not expecting that one. She's crazy, Harper. Okay. My number one... I'm shocked that none of y'all had this man on your top five. And
the boogeyman.
No.
Is it rude?
No, it's not rude. I went with Ricky Steamboat.
Yeah.
Like
I was thinking of him.
Let me tell you why, because I know Doc wants to shit on it, but like here's why Steamboat was my number one. I'm gonna ask you both a question. Harper, you first. Do you think Steamboat was a great promo guy?
Not really.
Okay. So the thing about Steamboat, because that's what Morton was really great at. Morton was a great promo. Can we agree on that one?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. So to me, the only reason Morton is not number one over Steamboat, for me as a wrestling fan, is Steamboat, while Morton could tell a story in the ring, Steamboat had to tell the story in the ring as a seller. Even that much more than like a Morton, because he didn't have the promo skills that a Ricky Morton had, or even a Ric Flair. As a heel, well, Flair was a heel, Morton was a babyface for the most part. So like, but you know, you think about those Steamboat matches, you know, with Flair, or even, you know, in the late 80s, or even when they feuded over, what was it, the U.S. title, I think, or the Mid-Atlantic, I can't remember. But, you know, yeah, Rick is in there, and Rick is selling, but Steamboat, I mean, if Steamboat can't sell... And do his role as a great babyface, that doesn't go over that great. So, like, that's why I put Steamboat up there, because I felt like he didn't have the promo skills of, like, a Dusty or a Ric Flair or even a Ricky Morton. But when he was in that ring, that motherfucker could sell and tell a story. And that's why he was my number one. That was the main reason. That's what made me put him over Morton when I thought about it. I was like, this guy didn't have the promo skills, but he got in there. And look, he didn't get the screams that Morton got, but he still got some cheers. Am I lying?
Yes.
Yes, I'm lying.
Your list started off wrong and it ended wrong, so I don't know what you want from me.
Fuck you. Yeah.
That's nice.
Any, you know, Doc, you the type of person where when you don't agree with something that a dude that another dude, you know, states, they automatically wrong.
That's exactly how that works. That is 100% how that works.
You are the most ethnocentric asshole I have ever met in my life.
What?
Ethanol.
You don't know what ethnocentrism is?
Listen here, just because you've been cracking books lately, don't make you smart. So
that
sounds
like that was my major at fucking Nunez.
I had to take a sip of drink because y'all choked me up on that one. Doc, but you're a prick. If somebody doesn't, you bully people at work, and you didn't, except for me, you ain't going to bully me because I could fucking take you down if I really wanted to. But anyway, you bully people all the time, and just because my pick doesn't line up with your view of the fucking universe, you got to shit on it. Okay. All right. Honorable mentions, Doc. What you got?
I did have Steamboat and Henning sitting right outside, and it was really tough to figure out a way to. And I just. Terry Funk got in because I thought it would be different, and I agree that Terry Funk sold longer. Here's one that I had that I think that all the sellers on this list would point to as a great seller, and that's Ray Stevens. And I did some. I looked up some later career matches of his. One is actually with the young Curt Hennig in the WWF. And, man, you talk about maybe that's where Hennig learned some things because Stevens was selling like a son of a bitch. So that was – and I had Shawn Michaels on my outside looking in too.
I had Ray Stevens as an honorable mention. The only reason he's probably not higher is just because I didn't get to see him growing up. You know, everybody that I had, it was people that I – you know, saw firsthand, but from everything I've read and the limited stuff I've seen, he was a hell of a fucking seller. That's for damn sure. Ray Stevens, that is. And yeah, Shawn Michaels, I give him an honorable mention. I mean, I'm not gonna shit on him that much, but go ahead, Harper. You had anybody else?
I had Rude and Sue. I had Rude, and I had Bret Hart.
What about Hogan?
Yeah, Hogan was a great seller. Those fucking foam fingers, they sold like crazy.
Oh man, yeah. All right, y'all. So appreciate it. That's our top five for this week. Hopefully, you
are you
going to
tell
it.
The people? Are you going to tell the people that we're done doing top fives?
What do you mean that?
I mean, you were just saying you were tired of this punk ass gimmick and that we needed to switch it up.
I didn't say nothing about that. What are you talking about?
Oh, maybe that's what I was thinking.
Yeah, exactly.
I like the top five enhancement guys.
We got that one, and next week is – shit, I got to look it up. I got to look up next week. But, yeah, we definitely got – we got a few more. Here's the thing. Eventually – I mean, y'all know this. Eventually, you're going to run out of top fives. You got to
switch it up. We do top five female workers.
We need to do this so long that we have a top five – best top fives we ever did.
Yeah.
I could live with that, I guess, at some point. Hey, let's get to it and then get it over to Tito Santana. So first time listeners, please subscribe to the show however you get your podcast, whether it's iTunes, Podbean, Stitcher, all that good stuff. And if on iTunes, like Doc said, throw us a 5-star review. We definitely would appreciate it. And then follow us on Twitter at @BTT_podcast. I'm at @Mike504Saints. Harper is at @CJHWhoDat. Him and all his escapades he always tweets out. I guess he's kind of like Mullet of Morton on Twitter from what I've seen. Just kidding. But hey, we appreciate you supporting the show. And if you want to support the show further, not only listening, become a patron member, go to mikemills.podbean.com, click the Become a Patron button, and become a $1 or $2 a month patron member. There's some benefits to it. We are still working on doing a patron-only show. I can tell you right now, I've been getting a lot of feedback. Doc, they want to know about the Dallas Cowboys Rat House. Can you imagine that? They want to know about that.
Well, the Dallas Cowboys draw interest when whatever they do and wherever
okay.
they go.
Okay. If you want to support the show, not just as a patron member and not just through PayPal, which, again, you can find at mikemills.podbean.com, go to the Amazon referral link, which is at the very top of the page. Click it. If you're going to buy stuff from Amazon, please use that. If not, oh, well, don't worry about it. I want to thank our sponsor, the Wrestling Palace, located in Traders Village, for those of you in the Dallas-Fort Worth area. They're your one-stop shop for your wrestling memorabilia needs. Just search the Wrestling Palace on Facebook And then if you know what you want, give my buddy Arturo a call, 469-337-8537. He can get whatever you want. So check them out. And lastly, I want to plug the 605 Super Podcast, King of the Mountain Podcast, and their Impact Wrestling Reviews, and the Wrestling Podcast About Nothing. My friends, the Kingpin, Brian Malonis, and Mike Crockett. Check out their shows that they do. All right, Doc, this week's promo of the week, I thought I'd ask you a question. It is Eric Young, right before he left Impact Wrestling. You recall that?
Oh, yeah.
Was that a good one?
There was some truth being told, I think. I think he was breaking kayfabe just a little bit there.
Yeah, he was talking about how he hate everyone. So that was the Impact Wrestling promo exit of Eric Young. That is going to be our promo of the week.
Where is Eric Young now?
NXT. He went over at their special this weekend. He's doing some good things. I predict within, I don't want to say 6 months, because Joe was on the NXT roster for a while before he just made his debut. But I'd say
what's Nakamura doing down there, rotting in NXT?
I don't know.
Yeah.
But I would say within a year, you'll see Eric Young on the main roster. I don't see why you wouldn't. I mean, Bobby Roode won the NXT title this weekend, so who knows?
Wouldn't you want to see Eric Young and Enzo Amore get into it with some sparring with some wordplay there?
That would be very entertaining. But you know what I want to see too? You and I have been Impact Wrestling fans for a while.
Two bitches get it on in a swimming pool of Jello?
Yeah, probably. That would be some good thing to watch. But remember Eric Young and Bobby Roode's feud in Impact? That was only watched by 300,000 people.
I was one of them.
Yeah, me too. I would love to see that on the main roster. I would, because those two guys can get after it.
Sure can.
And Eric Young can cut some vicious promos in doing so. But anyway, all right, y'all. I think that's it. Doc, you got anything before we throw it over to Tito Santana?
I got one quick thing, buddy. This is upcoming. This is Super Bowl Sunday. This is the week of the Super Bowl. So,
I'm not in it.
I know. It's unfortunate, but it's baseball season in Texas, so we're okay there. Let me just go ahead and ask, who y'all got in the big game this weekend?
Patriots.
No, Harper, who do you think is not? It's not who do you want to win. It's
who's going over.
Who's going over?
I think they're still going to win.
Okay.
They better fucking win.
Right. I'm sorry. A Saints fan cannot cheer for Atlanta.
No.
And I know we got some Atlanta fans.
Then why did you used to wear a Mike Vick jersey?
Dude, they got one of the shittiest fucking fan bases.
I was a heel, Doc. That's why.
You still are.
Okay. Harper, you think they got a bad fan base?
Yeah, they do, bro. They don't.
I'd like to apologize to all our fans in the Dirty South. The views of Harper are not. So now we've alienated women, Hispanics, and everybody who lives in the greater Atlanta area. Super.
They don't support the Braves, the Atlanta Hawks. I mean, fuck them.
I got the Patriots, Doc. Who you got, Doc?
Well, since I look a lot like Tom Brady, I'm going to go with the Patriots.
Yeah, all three of us are calling the Patriots, going over.
I like the heels, and so if the Cowboys can't be there, I like for the Patriots.
Yeah, I don't know about that, but I got the Patriots winning. William Shepard, I'm sorry, I know that Atlanta's your team. I just can't cheer for him, man. I'm a Saints fan, so but we appreciate your support of the show.
Oh.
All right, y'all, that's all I got. Doc doesn't have anything else. Harper, you got anything?
Nope.
All right, Harper, get us to Tito Santana's interview right now, brought to you by Main Event Madness, my friend Mark Madison over there on their podcast. So here it is. Harper, hit the tagline.
Book it, bitch. Arriba.
Fans will recall that as your time in the WWE early on, wrestling is maybe have a chance to change a bit. Fan base, workers, maybe from the beginning to the end of your time, would you say that you've seen a bit of a transition in wrestling from when you were first competing to where it is, where it was going and where it is today?
Yeah, without a doubt. I mean, I remember, when I first got to the, well, when the second time that I came to New York was when Vince took over from his father, and he brought, you know, all the stars from all over the country, and he was starting to take over the, you know, the country. You could see, you know, the transition from going to the high schools. And I remember Terry Funk, you know, telling us, you know, someday it's going to be old, you know, big buildings, and we're not going to be driving, and we're going to be flying all over the place. And sure enough, Terry Funk, you know, saw that, and, you know, it was on fire for quite a while. You know, the business caught on fire, and we all spent, you know, like I was there for the first 9 WrestleManias, and I guess Linda McMahon, you know, was thinking that we were all, I was like 39, and Hulk was probably 39, and she thought that we were getting pretty old, and, you know, she started thinking about, you know, making a transition with different stars, and, you know, from what we saw, it took a while, you know, to replace what they call now the legend.
Even going back a little further behind that, maybe you can clarify something. It said that you were trained early on by Bob Orton Sr.
Me and Tully Blanchard went to Tampa, Florida in 1977 to get started. And Cowboy Bob Orton, the son, was already, you know, established. Him and Bob Roop were the tag team champions, and I thought they were great workers. And his father was still working, you know, Bob Orton Sr. was still working. And me and Barry Orton were getting, you know, broken in by Bob Orton Sr. and Hiro Matsuda. So, as a matter of fact, I got to have a couple of matches with Bob Orton Sr.
Now, part of, I guess you've also had the, since you had the opportunity to work with his son, was it pretty seamless because there was chemistry and you knowing each other, or was that something you felt like you had to work with a little bit?
No, I mean, by the time I got to New York and I was pretty much, you know, I had matured in the business, I'm sure you can remember there was an era, man, when, you know, one worker was as good as the other. You know, whenever you stepped into the ring, you didn't have to worry about you going up against a guy who couldn't carry his weight. You know, we all knew the business. We all knew that, you know, we had to convince the fans that it was real and, you know, for us to make a living, and, you know, because we got paid on whatever we drew. So there was a bunch of hard workers, you know, in the ring, you know, and everybody was great.
What do you think some of the keys are to generating either? It seems like it's today's wrestling fan wants more, faster, bigger, quicker. But seeing wrestling change over the years, the need to generate cheers and jeers is different. What do you think has been some of the difference that was when you were competing actively as opposed to when you were competing, or what you see possibly today?
Well, I think the business, you know, has changed so much. I don't really know how, you know, how they get the fans to cheer, but I think, you know, the fans are programmed, you know, when a star is going to come out, and, you know, they start chanting for the star, and I don't know. I don't see a lot of wrestling in the ring, you know. I see a lot more talking, and when I do see wrestling, you know, I don't really see that the wrestlers really know what they're doing in the ring, and from what I understand, it's really not that important for the wrestler to know what's going on in the ring. Because it's a completely different ballgame. Now it's a TV show, so what they say and the stories that they're, you know, bringing out and, you know, run it. When we were wrestling, you know, we worked for the people, and we learned how to listen to the people and, you know, we did what the people wanted us to do in the ring. You know, it was an art. We had I can't think of the word, but we had we knew the business. You know, we knew what had to be done, and we would listen to the people, and we would do it. We didn't have to beg for cheers. You know, the fans got involved in the match, and then the fans got into dictating. You know, helping the babyface get out of trouble, and helping to make the comeback. And you know, the fan was really involved.
Where did that change, you think?
Well, the new workers. You know, they, like I said, there was a period when they got rid of the legends, and they just kept getting rid of more and more and more legends. And before they knew it, you know, they didn't have enough guys that knew the business to train the guys that were coming in. So they don't have the psychology. That's what I was looking for, the word. They don't have the psychology, and they'll never have the psychology because, you know, there's not too many. I would consider maybe, you know, Orton and maybe other than Orton, I don't really see anybody else who really I think has psychology in the ring right now. You know, once I think the last one was Stone Cold and The Rock. You know, I think once those guys left, you know, there's not many left that have ring psychology. But from what I hear, it's not important to have ring psychology anymore. You know, it's
which is a real shame.
Yeah, I mean, Greg the Hammer Valentine and I had the longest feud in the history of the WWE. We wrestled each other for about a year and a half, and nowadays a feud lasts maybe from one pay-per-view to another. You know, one month. You know, is the length of a big feud.
Now, you've had the opportunity to work for Vince. Any other promoters, promotions that you could say? Comparatively, I know Greg, I think, had the opportunity to work under Jim Crockett, but you were also partly with the AWA. Was there any, I guess, time under Vern Gagne a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, working, I also worked for Crockett Promotion, but I was just getting started, you know. Greg was established, so I was just up and coming. That was my second territory. And I was just learning, so I was just climbing the rope, and getting better and learning the business. But when I came to New York, and I was here in New York, and I was teamed up with Ivan Putski and became the World Tag Team Champion. And then Vince Senior told me that, you know, it would be better for me to go out and get more experience before I came back the second time around. So he asked me, you know, I kind of made Vince Senior my booker, and he says, "Where would you like to go?" And I said, "You know, well, my first choice is Minnesota because a good friend of mine was there. Dino Bravo and I had become real good friends, and so from one TV to the other, you know, Vince calls me in and he says, "Okay, your starting date in Minnesota is such and such, and your last day here is such and such, and then you go into Japan for 6 weeks and." So kind of when after I left here in 1979, the first time, Vince kind of became my, you know, any move that I made, I consulted with him, and you know, I kind of made him my booker.
You did just mention that you had one of the most successful feuds over the Intercontinental title with Greg the Hammer Valentine. Working also independently or singles, you've also had the opportunity to work as a tag. Opportunities are opportunities, but did you have a preference as to where you could really shine, or did you feel that both opportunities equally kind of presented themselves, new opportunities, if that makes sense?
Well, you know, opportunities were far and in between, you know, for a baby face. So, you know, my first big break was Tag Team Champions with Ivan Putski. Didn't last long. And then I, my next big opportunity I felt was when I had a chance to get the Intercontinental title. But, you know, I believe that I polished my work in the AWA because I was there for a little over 2 years, and you know, the AWA was one of the best territories. Everybody, you know, they didn't have 10 matches like they did in Madison Square Garden. They had 5 or 6 matches, and every match was, you know, could have been a main event. You know, you were working with nothing but top wrestlers, you know, day in and day out, and doing interviews and getting the experience, because, you know, the old-timers used to tell me back then, you know, the work that you do in the ring is about 10%. You know, it's what you say in the ring. It's what you say in the interview. And then whatever you say in the interview, you got to be able to back it up in order for the people, the fans, to believe, you know, start believing in what you say. So I believe that I really got polished in Minnesota with Vern Gagne because of the greatness of the talent that was there. But then I became the Intercontinental Champion, and I felt really comfortable, and I felt really, really polished, and I enjoyed. I knew I had faith in myself that I could carry the load in a singles match, and I could wrestle against, you know, all kinds of different sizes of heels. And, you know, I had a great run, you know, losing it and getting it back and losing it again. And then, you know, I was kind of not doing nothing for a while. And then the opportunity with Rick Martel appeared. And, you know, I took advantage of it. And unfortunately, again, that didn't last long because of something that happened in his family. He had to take some time off and go to Montreal it took about a year off. In the meantime, it left me in the dust. And after that, you know, I really didn't get any more breaks. You know, they promised me a big break when they did the El Matador gimmick with me, you know. But, you know, they never really had plans for El Matador.
So moving past the time, I guess, with the WWE, what other opportunities presented itself for you that you competed for a long time? I think fans had only really seen you in the WWE that have maybe national television, but your career was long-lasting and it really flourished. So where could fans have seen that you were still actively competing?
Well, I'm a school teacher full-time now. I teach Spanish in the middle school. I live here in Roxbury, New Jersey. But I do, you're right, I still enjoy, I stay in good shape, and I enjoy stepping into the ring, and I do small shows from time to time, you know, probably 2 or 3 a month, and I really enjoy it, you know. So if, you know, the fans ever hear that I'm going to be around, you know, I really enjoy the independent shows, because you get a chance to meet the fans one-on-one, you know, and a lot of times they bring up memories that I had long forgotten, and, you know, the only way I remembered is because, you know, they told me when it happened and how it happened, and, you know, it's really great to talk to the fans, you know, because you have a better appreciation, and you realize, because the wrestling fans, I mean, they feel like they're your friends, you know. If they're your fans, I mean, they worship you, and it's good to hear that as a wrestler, you know. We never got close to the fans, you know, like that. And, you know, we always, people like to hear, you know, how we entertained them and what we did for them and how important we were, us coming to their homes on television, you know, a couple of times a week, you know. It never gets old to get compliments.
Watching you, one of my earliest memories of you, not even necessarily you competing, although you were competing, but there's a certain person on commentary who would make a lot of comments about you and refer to you as Chico. That would then generally either generate heat for him, but really, was there a feud that was ever going to kind of come about with Jesse Ventura? It never really felt like it was going to be fully flushed out.
No, you know, Jesse the Body became such a big character, kind of like Bobby Heenan.
Yeah.
And we became good friends because they were both in Minnesota working for Vern Gagne. And Jesse the Body, I mean, they've asked Jesse the Body if he had a choice of working with one guy, who would he choose? And he's mentioned it on several interviews that, you know, he wrestled Tito Santana. I used to have some great matches with him. And when somebody that was over that strong, the insults that he'd throw at me, you know, and a lot of times I wouldn't even hear him because he was doing the commentating, were intended to help my career, you know, because they both liked me. And you know, my career was growing, and it was funny because, you know, I couldn't hear the commentating because I didn't watch the shows because we were always in the move. We were working like dogs back then. So yeah. It felt like we had time to watch the shows that were being produced. So I'd get to the arenas, and all of a sudden I'd hear the fans, "Hey, Chico!" And it kind of used to piss me off, you know, because I thought they were being prejudiced. And it took me a while to figure out it's because of what Jesse the Body's saying, you know. They don't mean it in a bad way. It just caught on, you know, from Jesse the Body Ventura.
Well, so wait a minute. There was you hadn't gone through things ahead of time saying, this is what I'm going to start referring to you as. Don't be surprised by it.
No.
It caught you off guard. That's crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah. Also, you had the opportunity to work with a lot of, you know, WWE legends as well, Hall of Famers as well. Working with Randy Savage, what would you have said about that experience and how that went through?
Well, Randy turned out to be, you know, one of the best heels and talent that came out, you know, through the WWF. But when he first, I mean, as a matter of fact, you know, when I first started in Georgia in 1977, Randy was also, I think he'd had one or maybe been around maybe 1 or 2 years already. So he was just a little bit ahead of me. But when he came to New York, Randy had never really been in a big territory and worked on top. So I was already the Intercontinental Champion. So we came in, Randy was still working the way he was working in 1977, just doing high spots for no rhyme or reason. And Randy grew a lot real quick here. I remember wrestling my first match against him in Detroit. I had a match with him, and I mean, I used to follow the heels. I mean, I used to let the heels call the match. And Randy is, you know, called the match, and we hardly heard any response, you know. The match just didn't get over at all. And, you know, Randy had just got here. He didn't even have Elizabeth as his manager yet. It took a while before they gave him Elizabeth. So after the match, I talked to Randy and I said, Randy, you know, you used to doing just high spots for no rhyme or reason. I said, we had a match tonight. If you hurt the crowd, you didn't get over. I said, I threw more drop kicks tonight in the match than I've thrown here in the last 6 months. I said, you're going to have to learn the New York wrestling fan, the East Coast wrestling fan. Here they like a little bit of wrestling and an ass-kicking fight. And then you give them a little bit more wrestling, and then some more. They want to see a good fight here. And he picked it up. He picked it up fast.
No question. Throughout your career, wrestling fans would probably be synonymous with knowing that Tito Santana was a babyface. Was there ever the idea or a thought of turning heel?
When Rick Martel turned heel against me after we split up and he was gone for a year and he came back, I asked Vince if I could be the one to turn heel. And Vince says, no, you know, we're going to turn Rick heel. I never had the chance to work as a heel. I would have liked to have been a heel, you know, because it seemed to me like, you know, the more knowledge you had about the business and the heel would always be the one that would control the match. I felt that I was a good worker, that, you know, a good enough worker where I think I could have been a good heel if they would have ever turned me. But I can't say that I ever had the opportunity to even test that.
So, okay, let's maybe fantasy plan a little bit, if you're okay with that. The idea of Tito Santana as a heel, What kind of things would fans maybe have anticipated had you tried to, had you been given the opportunity?
Well, you know, just like I studied the baby faces when I grew up, I would have been probably a combination of Mr. Wonderful, Paul Orndorff, and Curt Hennig. You know, because I believe that I was so good in the ring that I could be arrogant.
Yeah.
You know, just like those guys. I mean, those two guys to me, you know, were the top heels that I ever went up against. I mean, I had a great feud with Greg the Hammer Valentine. You know, he's a different level. You know, he was a blonde heel, and he was like a pit bull that just kept coming after you. But, you know, Mr. Wonderful and Curt Hennig, I mean, those guys were just unbelievably polished, you know, and smooth in the ring, and the way they, you know, they dealt with the fans. You know, they had a completely different, way of treating the fans. You know, they were so good that they didn't need the fans cheering for them.
Well, they blurred the line so often because whether they were face or whether they were heel, they seemed to remain the same. Whether they were getting a cheer or a jeer, their character never really needed to change. It was maybe a slight tweak, right? They almost walked the line of being a tweener, right? So
right, and mostly, you would do that in the interviews. You know, you would have to do very little in the ring. I mean, like Mr. Wonderful, you know, he would look at the fans only from time to time. You know, he'd turn around and argue, but you know, Mr. Wonderful did all his work in the ring. You know, he worked those fans. I wrestled him and without him and I having a feud in L.A. And there was a fan that all of a sudden I feel somebody, Paul had a hold on me, and a friend went in the ring and jumped on his back, and Mr. Wonderful flipped him over and started putting the boots to him. Never had I had been in a match where there was so much heat that a fan, you know, took a chance and jumped in the ring to help me.
Do you ever have the inkling to want to be involved in any other facet once your career? I mean, now you're happy and you are as a school teacher, but would the opportunity present itself? Did you, the idea of a road agent, helping to maybe teach the psychology that seems to be lost a lot in today's wrestling?
No, I have no desire to be on the road. The WWE offered me, you know, a couple occasions, you know, to become a road agent, and I spent enough time in the road. You know, I retired from the WWE when I had just turned 40. I was pretty young, and I was around my kids. I coached my kids in different sports as they were growing up, and me and Mr. Sergeant Slaughter tried to start a different league out of Chicago, and that only lasted a couple of years and folded, you know, ran out of money. And after that, I had no desire to go on the road again, you know, and be away from my family. It's not worth it. You know, I paid my dues already.
Oh, understood.
The business was good to me, you know, but, you know, I got out of the business what I needed.
You mentioned coaching and taking care of your kids. As a father myself, I definitely see that as a priority. But at the same time, was there ever an interest in your kids to want to follow dad's footsteps and want to pursue wrestling?
No. I think when my kids were little, you know, they loved the business. I used to take them with me. I remember one time being with the three of my boys. I have three boys, and I told them, I said, would you guys want to be away from your kids as much as I'm away from you guys? And I think that made an impact. And my kids are all, I mean, they're all very well educated. My oldest son's a lawyer, and my middle son graduated from Princeton, and as a matter of fact, he lives in Sierra Leone, Africa right now. And my youngest son, they all have the minimum of masters. My youngest son has a master's in accounting, and he works for a tech company, and they're all doing very well, you know. So this is a this is a tough, you know, wrestling was a tough business, you know, and I wouldn't want my kids to be away from their wives and their family like I was. You know, it's lonely being on the road and missing birthdays and missing anniversaries. You know, it's a lot of people think it's very glorious, but it really wasn't that glorious.
Well, do you see the number of dates? I guess because the WWE's grown, and they're competing 300 dates a year. When you were actively on the road, how much time would you have said was spent away and was demanded of you?
Well, back then I wrestled 350 days a year.
Wow.
You know, we were, and you know, you'd have like every 2 or 3 weeks, you'd have 2-3 days off, but one day you would, you know, you spend half a day flying from wherever you were at to get home, and then, you know, so you'd lose a half a day there, and then the following, you know, when you start, you leave half a day earlier because you had to fly to get to the town the next day. So, you know, you were lucky if you slept maybe two nights at home, like once a month.
That's incredible. Before we let you go, we did have a couple questions. Was there anything that, if fans want to be in touch with Tito Santana, if they want to connect with you, if they want to even just reach out and say thank you for, you know, entertaining me as many years and as much as you have, how could they best try to do so?
Well, I do have a website that I have a friend of mine that runs it out of Pennsylvania, and it's TitoSantana.net. And I am on Facebook now, believe it or not. I started texting not too long ago.
No problem.
You know, my generation, we weren't the generation with technology, you know, but I do text, and, you know, TitoSantana.net is probably the best way, or if they want to send me a message, like any bookings that I get, people find out, I mean, it's easy to get my phone number probably in the internet now. They can, to try to reach out to me or TitoSantana.net, because I do make appearances and I do still like to get in the ring. A lot of fans, you know, for they can write to, you know, Eisenhower Middle School here in Roxbury and, you know, send me a letter. There's a big show. I am going to WrestleMania and make an appearance at one of the signings, you know, in WrestleMania. I'm going to be there on April the 1st. And this Saturday I'm going to be at LaGuardia. I don't really have the address yet. I'm going to be riding with Greg Valentine and Anderson. I think it's a hotel in LaGuardia, you know, by LaGuardia Airport. It's called WrestleCon. So I am making an appearance there, along with a whole bunch of other stars that are going to be there. But whenever I'm around and you know, there's a wrestling fan that I haven't met yet, come by and say hello, and you know, let's talk about the past.
Fantastic. I think sometimes the past isn't so much behind us. We should be able to look at it and thank wrestlers like yourself that have really paved the way, because we can really have an appreciation for what was and what should still be. And we definitely want to thank you for that, Tito.
Thank you so much.
On behalf of my partner, John Curry, I'd like to thank WWE legend, former Intercontinental Champion, former WWE Tag Team Champion, probably one of what I believe is one of the most underrated wrestlers and performers in wrestling history, Mr. Tito Santana. Thank you very much for joining us here on Main Event Madness.
Thank you so much. Arriba!
Thanks again to my friends Mark Madison and John Curry from Main Event Madness, Madness Unleashed. Like I said, each and every Sunday they do a live live pay-per-view at 11:30 p.m. Central Time. You can find them on Facebook at facebook.com/maineventmadness, and their live shows and podcasts that they do on Sundays is at blogtalkradio.com/prowrestlingdotbiz. They do the current product, which, as you know, as we've evolved our show, we don't really cover the current product anymore. So, again, I appreciate the opportunity, John, to air the Tito Santana interview that Mark Madison did. Great interview from WWE legend Tito Santana. It was good to hear from him after all these years. I know that interview was done a while back, but still, I appreciate you allowing us to air it. It was some good stuff. So, yeah, thanks again, John, for that. And everyone, check out Main Event Madness in their current reviews of the current product, because, you know, we just really don't do that anymore. Before I get over to the promo of the week with Eric Young, I also have to give a couple of shout-outs, something that I missed earlier when Doc and I and Harper and I were recording. We had a couple of five-star reviews that I don't know if I've read on air recently, so I wanted to point those out. First one was from Blood Type Online. He says, "These guys are awesome. Lots of solid episodes here, but the gym are the Smoky Mountain Wrestling recap shows. Funny, entertaining, and a must for anyone who likes Smoky Mountain. Check it out. You won't regret it." Five-star review. He says, "It's a must listen." Thank you very much, Blood Type Online. Again, I can't remember if I mentioned that one last week, so I had to bring it up this week. And then I got one from The Bob, THABOB. On January 27, 2017, a five-star review, says, "Really fun show." The Bob was, he gave me some feedback, and I appreciate that, The Bob. Thank you so much for doing so. He says, "BTT and the Smoky Mountain Show are both two of my go-to podcasts. I really enjoy the Smoky Mountain Show better, as the main show suffers from terrible current-day WWE and on-and-off TNA to have to draw content from, so you can't blame the host for that." Hey, man, I appreciate that, because you nailed it with that one, The Bob. The Bob goes on to say, "The Smoky Mountain Show cracks me up every week listening to them trying to understand mountain culture and our sayings." I definitely agree, man. We are from the deep, deep south. One of us is from Texas, the other two from the deep south in New Orleans, and we are lost sometimes when it comes to the culture of Smoky Mountain. So that's why I always say on the Smoky Mountain Show, if we fuck something up, just tell us. We mean no harm. We're just trying to, we don't know. It's just not where we're from. He then goes on to say, "My only complaint, and I say this constructively, is the editing." No worries, man. I appreciate the feedback. He says, "I know Mike does the editing on his own, and he has a busy life. That being said, to take it over the top, I feel like more editing of the guys getting tongue-tied or muting themselves would be better cut out. And Mike, dude, it's okay to have an opinion. I'm sure some people are offended by anything, but if you feel some way about something, you don't have to explain why you feel that way. But I love this show, and unless you have been done wrong by the Rat and Roll Express or are a WWE mark, you need to add both shows to your rotation." The Bob, hey man, no offense taken. I appreciate the feedback. I'm working on doing some more editing, I agree. Sometimes it just becomes a time issue, so you are right, you nailed it, but I will try my best to do exactly what you're saying. I know with the Smoky Mountain shows, some weeks I do a little bit more editing than others. It's just simply because I have the time and they're pre-recorded enough in advance where I can do it. Other weeks, it's just I'm like, man, I got so much going on, I don't get to it as I probably could do so. But no, The Bob, thank you very much, man. I appreciate it. Look, you gave us a five-star review, so I thank you for your feedback, man. One thing I was always told was to thank people when they give you feedback, so I appreciate you giving us some feedback and a five-star review. And for the rest of you out there, you're listening to this and you're an iTunes listener, throw us a five-star review. We need all the five-star reviews we can get. And with that said, I want to thank Jason. He sent me an email. I got it very late in the game as we were recording the show yesterday. Or I say yesterday. Today is February the 2nd. We recorded the show on February 1st, but it's going to drop on February the 2nd, 2017. Jason said, "WWE managed to shit on five championships on Raw and SmackDown. The idiots pinned five champions in 2 days." Yeah, I think we talked about that during the body of the show. "And that's not including both shows' tag titles that also were shit on by defending one on the Rumble pre-show, and the other wasn't even defended at all." I totally agree, Jason. "Jesus, now to get the prestige back, Hunter will have to book himself to win them all at the same time." Now, I wouldn't be surprised. I don't think that'll happen, but it wouldn't shock me at all. "Thank goodness we have Smoky Mountain to look forward to." Jason, I totally agree. Smoky Mountain is the highlight of our weeks. We enjoy doing it every single week. So, yeah, I would tend to agree with you, man. So I appreciate that, Jason. Let's see. I think that's almost it. We got to, you know, I just want to plug our, you know, like I said, check out the Wrestling Podcast About Nothing with Mike Crockett and Brian Malonis. And I want to congratulate Brian Malonis again. He may be next week's show guest. We haven't recorded yet, so I'm maybe going out on a limb to say that. But we should be doing some recording soon. And Brian Malonis, as I said, is now in the Ring of Honor Top Prospect Tournament that is, as this airs, hasn't taken place yet. So if you're listening to it after, he may have already competed in it and may have won it, or who knows. But I hope I wish Malonis all the luck in the world, even though he hates Southern wrestling, and he and I go back and forth on Twitter about that. But anyway, so shout out to him. Hopefully he's next week's guest, and go listen to the Wrestling Podcast About Nothing with him and Mike Crockett. They've had on Warbeard Hansen. They've had on Donovan Dijak. They've had on Todd Sinclair from ROH. They've had on a ton of ROH guests, and I want to say they even had a short interview with Tommaso Ciampa from NXT about 6 months ago or so. Could be wrong, but check them out. Wrestling Podcast About Nothing. Just search them and you will find them. They're also on the New Age Insiders Network podcast. So, and then a shout out to my Impact Review friends, BQ, doing the Impact Wrestling Review. Check them out. King of the Mountain podcast. If you like Impact Wrestling and like a full review show, check them out. They dive into each and every episode fully each week. I think they missed last week. There were some audio technical difficulties with BQ's computer, but each and every week they do a show on just Impact and Impact alone. And then, like I said, check out, I've also always promote the 605 Super Podcast and Main Event Madness Podcast for your current like WWE needs. With all that said, that's all I got. I'm going to throw it over now. I know the close of the show was a little long this week, but I had to get those shout outs to some of our listeners. Let me throw it over now to Eric Young in his departing promo as he left Impact Wrestling last year. I really thought it was good. At the beginning of it, I swear he was just with that I hate everybody. It really captivated me. So let's throw it over now to Eric Young's Impact Wrestling promo from a year ago as he left Impact Wrestling. You know what we always say when we get it over to the promo? Book it, bitch.
What impact are we about to have now? Eric Young has the microphone.
Look at the eyes. Look at the eyes of Eric Young. This man has truly lost his mind.
I hate everybody in this building. I hate all of you idiots. And I hate everybody in the back. You're looking at the most dangerous man in professional wrestling. With the most dangerous hold in professional wrestling. You're looking at the king of wrestling, and here's my proof. Nobody can beat me. Everyone's tried, and nobody can do it. And that brings me to the next piece of business. TNA Wrestling, you want to suck up to punks like EC3. You want to cater to has-beens like Jeff Hardy. And you want to suck up to the golden boy, that marble-mouthed Scottish punk, Drew Galloway. I'm doing the messing from here on out, because this is the last time you're going to see me.
I think you expected that.
That's right.
I'm taking my King of the Mountain title, and I'm taking my talent, and I'm leaving. Take a good, hard look, TNA. Me and Bram, we're out of here. We quit.
Eric, you just quit for both of them?
Bram, come on.
Oh, well, it looks like it. He's telling Bram to come on, but Bram's not moving.
Thanks, Captain Obvious.
Shut up, you pigs. Bram. Bram, let's go. Now.
I'm not going anywhere, everyone.
What did you say?
I said, I'm not going anywhere, Eli. I'm sick and tired of being your bloody lackey. Sick and tired playing second fiddle to you.
Okay, I see what's going on here. You want to be alone. You don't want to stay under the wing of the greatest, the most dangerous man in wrestling? Fine. Stay here by yourself, loser.
Where are you going, Eli? That belt looks rather heavy, mate. I think that belt will look better around the waist of a real man. But I don't think you got the balls.
The most devastating maneuver in all of professional wrestling.
Now what? Loser!
Eric Young's real proud of his actions here tonight.
I'm the king, and all of you are not.
Looks like Eric Young is taking his ball and going home. Eric Young saying earlier that he quits. And now what is he doing? What's wrong with this guy?
Bram. Bram.
Look at his hand. A pair of scissors.
Oh, no.
You grew this beard because of me. I'm the only one to have allowed that beard in TNA, in professional wrestling. I'm the first. I'm the greatest. I'm God.
What is Eric Young talking about?
He's psychotic. He's lost his mind. And he's cutting the beard off the face of Bram.
Psychotic, yeah. Eric Young's $1 million talent, but he's running on 10% brain. Unreal.
Eric Young is coming completely unglued. Totally unhinged. Yes. King of the Mountain champion, calls himself God. Said that he's the only one in professional wrestling allowed to have a big... That he was the first.
Yeah, I call himself King. I mean, talk about... being full of yourself.
It's gone to a completely different level and a new depth for Eric Young.